Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm glad to see you, those of you that have joined us this morning. And we also welcome anyone who may be joining us by video for worship today. Glad that you are with us. Well, let me send out our birthday greetings for those that celebrate this week. And that includes Lisa Andrews, Christine Stearns, and Chloe and Joey Borgia. So hope that they have a good birthday on their special day. For announcements, today is First Sunday Potluck, so if you want to stay and have lunch with us, you are most welcome. Youth Night tonight is a Super Bowl fellowship at the home of Angie and Johnny McClanahan. You can contact them, contact Weston, contact Brother Mike if you need directions for that. Be aware that that is starting at 5, and then I'm guessing they can just hang out until the game is over, so whenever that will be. Remind you that our Wednesday discipleship has started back up, so you're welcome to join us for that. And we have a church board meeting next Sunday, February the 14th. Well, as we begin our worship today, I invite you to stand as we open our hearts and our minds to the Lord and hear from His word this morning. How good it is to sing praises to our God, for He is gracious, and a song of praise is fitting. The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the outcasts of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He determines the number of the stars, and He gives to all of them their names. Great is our Lord and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make melody to our God. May the Lord bless His word.
Good morning and welcome. So good to see you with us today. Let's pray together. Gracious Heavenly Father, we are indeed thankful that we can gather in your house, that we can come together to glorify and magnify your name and to worship you today. We pray your blessing upon our gathering. We ask you, Holy Spirit, come, empower us that we would be able to worship you well and be pleased, our God, with our worship. We pray your blessing on all that's said and done. Use this day, use this time to build us up into the image and likeness of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Good morning, y'all. We're going to start off with 71. Page 71.
Just for the record, I think it's absolutely okay to clap in church.
There's a clap, clap.
However, clap, do not follow my lead. I have to confess to you that the reason you never see me clap in church or anywhere else really is because I cannot keep time. Yes, Facebook world, whoever, I really cannot keep time. No, everybody and their brothers tried to teach me how. 6 years of piano lessons, cannot keep time. And you can't read notes and make music if you can't work out the timing. You know how disgusting that is to find out 6 years later. Poor mom and dad. What? Maybe they should have spent that money on something else. But so if you want to clap, and you can clap and praise the Lord that way, I want you to feel absolutely free to do that. Just understand that if I did that, it wouldn't be very praiseworthy. It would just sort of be distracting. Oh, it's good to be with you today. And who is waiting on us for our tithes and offerings this morning? They know that. I see one. I see one. I see two. Cool.
I'm sure somebody else wants to take my spot.
Oh, let's not do that. You need to stay in practice.
Right, yeah, I don't want to forget. It's been a long time.
Let's pray together. Gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for allowing us to come into your house to contribute to your work, and what we ask is that you would bless the offerings we bring into your house today. Make us good stewards of the resources with which you entrust us. And for that portion that we give back to you, make us as a church good stewards, that we might use these resources to do the work of the kingdom of God in this place and this time. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen.
Disappointed this morning because you wanted to see snow? I'm the only one as a teacher coming out and me going, come on, come on. How many of you are like, yes, there's no snow? Shame. Listen, I watched the news. I won't point out which station, but they disappoint me a lot lately. But you know what? We get to come and worship the one that never disappoints us. The God that loves us, says he'll never leave us or forsake us, and you know that's the truth. Even though the snow didn't show up, they're just human. But we're here to worship the Almighty God. On that note, if you are 3 years old through sixth grade, Miss Michelle is ready to teach you awesome things about him. Yeah. I didn't know. All y'all were praying for no snow. That's what it was.
They beat you.
Our prayer for snow.
It's all good. I just wanted to go play. Well, in that case, whether they wanted snow or not, you still need to turn around and look at them and say, good morning. Because we're going to love them no matter what.
All right, let's continue on. 33, page 33.
I see the stars.
Somebody who's really talented in that strange songwriter kind of way, because we need another verse squeezed in about verse 3, and it needs to mention something about the boat and the water and the fish.
I mean, woods and forest
lake. Well, I think we ought to have a specifically fisherman reference. You know, Jesus spent a lot of time with fishermen. I think it would be okay for us to have one of those. And then a few others of us could get really blessed about, you know. Actually, I think we can all be blessed. What a great God we have. Do you have prayer requests that you'd share with us this morning? While you're thinking about that, here's my list. Remember our nation, our healthcare workers and hospital staff, armed forces, all agents of law enforcement and first responders, baby Jacob and the Richardson family, Randy and Saline, Reddick Scott, Gary Beard, Larry Tarkington, Michelle's dad, Bill Cheatham, Angie's cousin, Dennis, Charles and Shirley recovering, all of those really recovering from or fighting COVID, our schools, teachers, students, and always pray for children, and others that you would add to that list. Unspoken prayer request you might want to indicate this morning. Let's pray together today. Gracious Heavenly Father, we are indeed thankful that we can gather in your house and call upon your name and be heard. Think that the God of the universe would listen when we, his creatures, call upon him. Today, Lord, we call this great number of people on our prayer list to your attention. In general, we pray for our nation. We pray for all those involved in health care, especially those in hospitals. We pray for our soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, Coast Guard, National Guard, law enforcement, first responders. We ask that you'd be with baby Jacob, help him to recover from his most recent surgery and gain health and strength. We pray for Randy and Saline, that they will get well. Pray for Reddick, that you'll give him strength, for Gary Beard and his recovery, for Larry and his fight against cancer, and Bill, his fight against cancer. Pray that you'd be with Dennis. We ask that you would be with Charles and Shirley and help them to recover. All those fighting COVID, how we pray for those of our friends and acquaintances, co-workers, all those peoples our lives intersect that we know of who are fighting COVID and recovering, fighting its effects. For Scott Williams, his battle against cancer. For Tricia, waiting on the results of this biopsy. For Laurel. And for Lisa, how we pray that you would be with them. For our schools and teachers and students, how we ask that you would be with them in these trying days. We always pray for our children. And today, Lord, we ask that you'd be with those unspoken prayer requests indicated in your house. We trust that you know the deep needs of our lives, that we speak not in public, but only in the quietness of our heart do we call out to you. So we leave them in your hands, trusting that you can do more than we can imagine or think or sometimes even believe. And so we pray, be at work and increase our ability to have faith in you. Bless now, I pray, the remainder of this service, our time together, that we might hear from the Word of God, truth that helps us to live lives that are pleasing to you, to have the very image of Christ formed inside of us, and to follow where you lead. In the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. If you have your Bibles today, I'm going to invite you to find the book of Isaiah, Old Testament, Isaiah, chapter 40. You're looking for chapter 40. Chapter 40, verse 21 is where we'll begin. Isaiah 40, verse 21. Hear the word of the Lord from Isaiah 40, beginning at verse 21. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told to you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth when he blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see who created these. He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is an everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless.
Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint. May the Lord bless the reading of His word. Where is God in your life? I mean, where does He show up? And when He does show up, do you recognize that it's God who has shown up? I don't know how many of you are familiar with that seminal work from sort of my childhood, The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, with those wonderful, famous words that we should all always remember, especially in these days, written on the cover, that make it so important. Do not panic. Do not panic. I'm thinking actually about a quote from that book. Douglas Adams may not have believed in God, but that doesn't mean he didn't write some pretty interesting stuff. Put some things in very funny ways. He says this. He says, space is big, really big. You just won't believe how vastly, hugely, mind-boggling big it is. I mean, you may think it's a long way down the road to the chemist, but that's peanuts compared to space. I kind of wish maybe that author had understood what was behind that bigness. So to paraphrase his words, I did this. I said, God is big. I mean, really big. You just can't believe how vastly, hugely, mind-boggling big He is. I mean, you may think space is big, but that's peanuts next to God. And that God, I mean, that vastness, powerfulness beyond all imagining or thought, I mean, try someday to just think about something outside of the universe. You can't get there. You can try, but even the structures of our thoughts are sort of bound in by our experiences and our frame of reference, and the best we can do is sort of think about really big and then think something beyond that, God. Because God doesn't fit in your categories. He doesn't fit in your thought patterns. His power, His greatness, His might exceeds our ability to think or imagine. I mean, quite literally, mind-boggling. As in, just sit around and contemplate the greatness of God for just a few minutes, and you'll get totally beyond what your mind can boggle. And that's a good thing. We will circle around to why that is such a good thing. But trust me, folks, you want a God that's bigger than any box you can put Him in. You want a God that's more powerful than any thought you can have. You want a God that's bigger than any universe that you can live in. Because one of these days, you're going to run smack dab up against something that's bigger than you thought you would ever have to deal with in your life. And when you do, you want a God that is bigger than your thoughts. God, this really big God, this God who flings the universe into existence. I mean, you get Isaiah the prophet, you get what he's saying here. He's trying to sort of paint this picture of how big, how powerful God is. And so he uses the vastness of the heavens. He uses the strength and power of the known, the earth, the dwelling place where we are. And he likens the whole of the universe. For God, it's like a tent. He just throws it up. Like you pitch a tent. God just pitches universes. What is amazing to me is that someone so long ago uses this metaphor. It worked for Isaiah. It works for us. Even though we now have the Hubble Space Telescope, it can see further into outer space than anything has ever seen before. And it's shown us beauty and vastness. I mean, our knowledge of the created universe is larger than it's ever been. And unfortunately, our God has not necessarily grown with our knowledge of the greatness of the universe that he flings about like a tent. But it should have. It should have. And the vastness of our God, his bigness, his power, his majesty, beyond our reckoning. Instead of recognizing it and allowing our God concept to grow as our universe has grown, instead it's shrunk. Shrunk to the point that for many, many people, God just doesn't exist. And for many, many more, whether or not a God exists, he doesn't matter. And that's the world we find ourselves in. Not terribly unlike the world of the ancient Jews hearing the prophet Isaiah, who have been captured, seized, deported, taken off into a foreign land where they worship foreign gods, and where their God has been diminished to either nothing or one among many gods. And Isaiah has done plenty to lament the plight of the exiles. And he's beginning to turn. The work of Isaiah, the words of the prophet, are beginning to turn to something new. Something that calls forth the hope of God's people, and it is founded in the vastness of the power of the one true and living God. The God that created the universe. He reminds his hearers that their God, our God, is not subject to the rulers of the earth. As a matter of fact, compared to the rulers, the mighty princes and kings of our planet, those kings, those very kings and powers that have seized God's people and thrown them into exile, destroyed their temple and deported them and turned them into slaves and servants in a pagan land, those who would try to tear down the memory of God, that in fact, to compare God to those powers, it's like God sits enthroned above all of those powers. And not just those powers, but above all of the created powers. Above everything in the natural universe, God is above all of that, so much so that that big king who makes so much noise and appears to do so much damage to the message of God and the people of God. He's just like grass. He pops up one day, a little shoot out of the ground. He grows for a little bit. He withers, he dies. He turns to dust. He blows away. So why fret, people of God? I mean, that's what Isaiah says. Why fret about these kings or princes or the powers of this earth? Why spend any energy worried about them? Follow, serve, put your attention on the greatness of your God, the God who calls all things into being, because there's none like Him. There is no equal. There is no rival for the Lordship of God. At least, not really. And if you put something in place of God, that may block you from God, but it doesn't diminish God's greatness. Have you not heard? Some have not, because some don't listen. It's not that the great God of the universe isn't the great God of the universe. It's just some people refuse to acknowledge it. Some people refuse to surrender to that greatness for all kinds of reasons. But it doesn't diminish His greatness. And then there's the plight of the people of God. This people in exile. And they long to go back to what they knew. Think about it. The people of God, the nation of Israel, Judah, they longed to go back to what they knew. They longed to go back to the ideal in their head. Right? They longed to go back to a historic time and place where they were the people of God and they were important and they had a big temple and it was beautiful and wonderful, and they longed to go back. I can't help but think that I live among a people in exile. I live among a people who have a memory of the way it used to be. I've only got a little span on this planet. But all of my life, I have listened to people long to go back to the good old days. I have a feeling if you were twice my age, that excludes everybody in here today, although some of you are quite a bit older than me. I'm not saying you're old, I'm just saying you're older than me. My question is, have you ever lived in a day when people didn't long to go back to the good old days? My guess is we, like the people Isaiah speaks to, we're just like people, because we are people. And our tendency is to want the comfort, to want the security, to want the prominence, to want the good old days, to want what was. But that's not what God promises. It's just not what God promises. What God does promise is that wherever the future unfolds, whatever that future goodness or that future discomfort may be, that God will be with you. I mean, that really big, vast, huge, mind-boggling God will be with you. And whether that future is comfortable or uncomfortable, the God for whom the whole of the universe, the whole of the night sky, the whole of the stars and things that Hubble can't see, that vast power will be with you, will go with you into whatever that future is. The people of Israel, the nation of Israel, the nation of Judah, the people of God that heard Isaiah's voice, they got to go home. They got to go back. They got to go back to the land they used to occupy. It eventually happens. And what did they go back to? Well, they surely didn't go back to the way it had been. They didn't go back to the good old days. As a matter of fact, when they went back, they went back to a city in ruins, a nation in ruins, a nation that had been crushed, a nation that really was no more, a land that was now populated by people who had moved in while they were away, and a temple that had been turned into rubble. Probably not the homecoming they had dreamed about or sang songs about while they were in exile. Not the future they hoped for. But God was with them. And when God goes with you, even back to a ruined land, when God goes with you back to a city that is rubble, you know what you do? You pitch a tent. And you rebuild. Stone upon stone upon stone. You rebuild. And you make the best of the future. And maybe you don't get to enjoy that great new future. Maybe for you the great new future is just a whole lot of work, a whole lot of trouble, a whole lot of pain, a whole lot of labor, a whole lot of grind. Whole lot of, oh, what might have been, but instead of dwelling there, you'll be pressed forward by, oh, what might can be for those who come after me. Those people rebuilt a nation. They rebuilt a city. They rebuilt a temple. And they cradled a hope that one day, that really, really big God would do something new, would do something more than he had ever done. We call that Jesus, God's Messiah, the vastness of the God that flung the universe into existence, now squeezed into one walking, talking human being so that all of God might be made known to all of us. And that we might finally see that the God we cannot see, the God that is so vast and beyond our mind's ability to comprehend, walks with us. Talks with us, loves one person, is so concerned about people that he'll go out of his way to talk to an outcast woman at a well among an outcast people. He'll get in a boat and cross the sea to go to a people who aren't even his people and tell them about the goodness of God. He'll come back across that sea, partially in a boat and partially walking on the water maybe, so he can touch the life of one distressed woman, raise one dead girl back to life, free one poor soul from demonic possession, and then walk into Jerusalem and surrender himself so he could hang on a cross and die for you and for me, so that our future could include God with us. People of God, it's time. It's time to quit looking back. It's time to quit thinking about the way it was. And it's time to start looking forward to the way it can be. God can do more than he's ever done before. God can make a way where there is no way. In a nation that seems like it's turned its back on God, among a people who have forgotten what it is to serve God, God can do more than he's ever done. In a life that has been ruined for want of knowing God and following him and serving him, a life that's fallen to pieces, a life that you just don't see how tomorrow's going to be, we have a God who can walk right into that mess and bless you. Bless you with his presence and bless you with his power and bless you with a future that's better than you can imagine. Because any future with God is better than any past without him. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Would our musicians come? You might have to get everybody to stand up.
Yeah, stand up, y'all. 122. Thank you.
Let us pray together. Our great, big, and wonderful God, thank you. Thank you. That you are not so big as to stay in heaven forever. But in fact, you have come to us, given yourself to us in the person of Jesus, that we may know you. How I pray that we, your people, trusting in your name, will walk boldly into a new future where your power with us will renew our strength, so that they will say of us, your people, they mounted up with wings like eagles. They ran but did not grow weary. They walked and did not faint. Into that great future that you have for your people, people empowered by your presence and surrendered to your will. Bless now, I pray, those who have come into your house, meet a blessing out for each one, fit for their needs in the coming days. Help us, by the power of your Holy Spirit, to follow where you lead. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.